So, you couldn't find anything?
Not yet. There are a lot of demonic amulets, but few don't seem to match anything like a power booster.
Alright. What about the NCRC? Anything on them?
I have a few data taps on them right now. It did yield some potential targets.
Alright, hit me.
The first one is an NCRC researcher flying in tonight. He's been abroad, and supposedly has research that could make a huge revelation for the scientific community about all the stuff going on recently. The other one is a conference going on across town. A small group of researchers apparently found some artifacts that might be related to demons.
Great. Both of those sound like what that prisoner spoke about.
I'll keep tabs on them. If I find a more definite lead, I'll text you the details.
You can text? You sure you're not going to give yourself a headache?
Ha ha. Shut it. You should get back to class.
School's out for now. Oh, I do gotta head somewhere, though. I'm gonna be late. I'll see you tonight.
See ya.
Vincent Valentine gave a heavy sigh over piles of books. He had been going through every one of his books that held known demon artifacts that could describe what Ghost Rider told him. There were many known demonic amulets, but very few had the qualities of the one this Vanitas was looking for. He placed the books down and stood up. Stretching his back, he walked over to his computer to see if his data tabs came up with anything. Just then, he heard the door open to the tower behind him. Frowning, Vincent turned to the doorway.
I thought you were heading out somewhere. What are you doing here?
Vincent's eyes widened when he saw standing at his doorway a woman with long, light brown hair. A cold metal pistol trained on him with nerves of steel that matched eyes of killing intent.
Hello, Vincent.
Roxanne? How?
Did I find you? Not too hard to follow a 15-year-old who sneaks out every night.
Roxanne closed the door behind her and kept her gun trained on Vincent.
Now, let's have a talk about my son, shall we?
She kept the pistol trained on Vincent as she slowly moved into the room.
So you're back in the city, huh?
I've been back for a while now, actually. Just been keeping quiet.
I think we both have a very different interpretation on the word quiet.
Roxanne's eyes wandered throughout the room before she settled them back on the vampire.
It's him, isn't it?
Vincent didn't answer, for he didn't want to tip his hand too soon. Unfortunately, the reporter forced everything in that hand to spill over.
Sora is the Ghost Rider, isn't he? I know the signs. I know when my son is lying to me. There's also this.
She took a USB drive from her pocket and placed it on the table.
Footage of you helping out at the prison break last night. You're either getting careless or really out of touch with modern technology.
She spotted the old windows gathering dust on the desk.
It's obviously the latter.
Put the gun down, Roxanne. They don't work on me anyway.
This one does.
She tilted the gun slightly to let Vincent get a better look at it. When he did, the vampire grimaced.
You found his armory.
He left me the key to it.
She lowered the gun.
I was hoping not to use it, though. As long as you're cooperative.
You were always a spitfire. Things haven't changed that much, it seems.
Don't make me change my mind. Now answer my question.
You're the reporter. If you were able to track me here, it's obvious you already know. Unless you were actually hoping, I would tell you otherwise.
How? How did this happen?
The same thing that happens to every ghostwriter. There is always a deal.
Roxanne grabbed one of the chairs, feeling the very strong need to sit down.
When?
He says when it was around 7, I think. 7 or 8.
I thought you said Mephisto couldn't take the souls of young children.
It... No, he can't. But he found a way around that.
Vincent shifted uncomfortably as he recalled what Sora said the exact nature of the deal was.
And then he found you?
No, I found him. The first night of his transformation, 3 months ago.
3 months ago. Of course.
Anyway, I brought him here and told him what he was. Since then, we have been fighting monsters.
Does he know about...
No. I told him nothing about that. He doesn't even know about you. It wasn't something I should tell him.
Yes.
Roxanne trailed off for a moment, deep in thought before she snapped out of it, standing up from her chair.
Yes, good. You made the right choice. Now, I have something else I need you to do.
And that would be?
You're going to convince my son to stop.
Vincent didn't react. No eyes widening or outbursts of how she can't ask that of him.
That was the wrong move.
Vincent walked up to her, which caused the reporter to lift up the pistol again.
Don't even.
In a flash, Vincent had grabbed the pistol from her hands, and within seconds he pulled it apart, dropping the pieces at their feet. He made no other move, no attack, just stood there with a now useless pistol on the floor.
You played a very good bluff, but you gave your hand away with that move. We both know nobody who becomes the Ghost Rider simply stops. They can't. Even if Sora didn't have his sense of justice, the Rider does. The Rider makes sure vengeance is dealt, no matter how hard the human represses it. You know that, and I know that. So once I failed in convincing Sora to give up, you would then lay down your real plan, to get me to cut ties with Sora. I can't allow that. He may be the Ghost Rider, but he has no experience in this. He is running on pure instinct. He needs someone to show him how things are done. You get rid of me. You get rid of the only chance Sora has to survive.
Roxanne spun around in fury to the door, giving one final warning before slamming the door shut.
Stay away from my son. I've already seen what your help has done to my family.
Some of you may be wondering how a girl like Yuffie can eat huge portions of Mexican food and not gain a lot of weight. You could say it's her high metabolism. You could also argue that she eats everything else light, and therefore can eat a lot of one other thing. You could use any one of those to explain it, but you can't use those to explain why huge amounts of money vanishes whenever Yuffie orders Mexican. As these three boys slowly watch their money whittle away, with their single portion meals versus Yuffie's feast-sized meal.
Can't tell you guys how much I love Mexican,
Yuffie said in between bites of enchilada. Wakka looked at her with the most deadpan expression.
No, I think we can tell. Aren't you going to get sick if you eat all that?
Nope, never do,
Yuffie said with a smile.
My mom used to make Mexican every Saturday night. It was our tradition, before she...
Yuffie's smile faded oh so briefly at the mention of her mother before she took more bites of her food. Tidus gave an uncomfortable throat clearing and stood up.
I'm gonna go use the bathroom. I'll be right back.
No one seemed to really notice, so he shrugged. Walking to the bathroom, he rounded the corner to the bathrooms when something caused him to stop. Someone, actually. A woman, he could tell. Mostly because as she was tying her shoes, she was bent over to the point where Tidus got a nice little image of her. Let's not be crude and say, rear end. Normally, he would turn around out of respect. But since he was sure she wasn't looking, he could admire the view a little bit longer.
It's not nice to stare, you know.
So much for that. Tidus blushed uncomfortably as the woman stood up and turned around. She looked around his age, maybe older, with short brown hair, and despite that she was wearing sweaters and long jeans, they were very curvy around her.
I wasn't staring. I mean, kinda. I mean, a little, but not intentionally. I mean, I wasn't really staring so much as, you know, noticing. Yeah, noticing. I was only noticing.
The woman was amused all the way through his defense before she chuckled.
Oh, I'm not mad. There's nothing wrong with looking.
Really?
Yep. Touching, however, that's a no-no. And most boys I run into don't seem to get that. Except you.
She gave a smile that was riddled with attraction and great interest.
Congratulations. You're the first not to touch.
You're welcome?
Say.
The woman started, putting a finger to her chin.
You wouldn't happen to attend the high school around here, would you?
Yeah, I do, actually. Why? Do you go there too?
I thought about it, but I was actually looking for someone that may be at your school. Maybe you know him?
Oh, really? Who?
He might be a senior. Vincent Valentine?
No. Sorry, never heard of him.
The brunette gave a pouty smile as she sauntered up to him.
Are you sure you don't remember?
It's possible I forgot, but I...
The girl lightly pushed him against the wall, her fingers on his chest, and walking up to his neck. Each word fell into the beat of the movement of her fingers.
Should I jog your memory?
Tidus blushed as red as the sunset, and his mouth failed to form proper words. As he was eye to eye with her heterochromia blue and green eyes, as her fingers reached the head of his hoodie, she brushed oh so lightly against his neck. The suggestions were all there as plain as day, the invitations, yet Tidus kept his hands firmly where they were, at his sides, which caused the brunette to give a strange smile.
Congratulations again.
She gave a light tap on his cheeks.
You silly, fascinating boy.
You're welcome?
The brunette gave a smile and stepped away from him.
Maybe I'll see you around.
Hey, wait!
Tidus tried to call out, but the girl disappeared into the restaurant. He had thought about following her, but then he remembered he really needed to use the bathroom.
Thanks for coming with me today, you two. Sometimes it's nice to escape the winter wonderland.
You may be wondering, how exactly can someone manage to escape winter in the middle of December? The answer lies at the recreation center, where for a small membership fee you can enjoy a nicely heated pool and get your summertime in December. As you guessed, being the daughter of the mayor has those perks too. And today Kairi decided to extend those perks to some close friends.
It's no problem. I finally get to try out this swimsuit anyway.
Aerith and Cloud had decided that their winter studying priorities could be put aside for one day to join Kairi. Cloud had a membership, so he was covered. Aerith's expired some time ago, so Kairi was more than willing to list her as her guest.
Alright, while you two get Aerith her guest pass, I will meet you two inside. Sound good?
Alright.
Aerith stopped to plant a small kiss on Cloud's cheek.
See you inside.
I didn't know you two were getting serious.
Well, kind of.
Kind of?
It's complicated.
I'm a good listener.
Aerith made a face as the two of them walked down the hallways. She gave a sigh.
I do like him. I do. But at the same time, I'm not sure if I like him. You know?
Does he know you feel this way?
No, I haven't told him. Because I don't know if I want to let go of someone like him. What if he turns out to be the right guy, and I shut him out without giving him a chance? No, I'm going to wait a bit. See what falls into place.
Kairi didn't really approve of this line of thought. She wanted to speak her mind, but she had to stop and recall that Aerith was her own person, and she would make her own choices.
I understand.
Thank you. I thought you would, considering your own boy troubles.
My what? Boy troubles? With who?
Sora. My understanding is now he's Mr. Nice and Sensitive.
I have no idea what's going on with him. These past 3 months, for some reason, he's all smiles and helpful. I'm waiting for that moment where the bomb drops and he does something Sora-like, but nothing has happened.
I think it's rather interesting. Don't you want to know why he's acting like this?
No, and honestly, I don't want to talk or think about Sora Shimomura right now.
The two girls had made it to the registration counter.
Hi, my friend needs a guest pass for the pool.
The boy sitting in the chair at the counter spun around to Sora Shimomura's face.
Sure thing. What's your membership account name?
What the hell?
Sora typed for a moment and frowned.
Yeah, no, sorry. No account name, what the hell?
Aerith chuckled while Kairi remained flabbergasted.
You know... Never mind. What are you doing here? You don't work here or anything, do you?
What, me? No, I'm just filling in for Barbara while she's on maternity leave.
Who?
The lady who is usually behind this counter. Nice lady. Anyway, I've been doing a lot of volunteer work and they need someone to fill her spot in, so that's me.
Kairi stood there, jaw moving up and down for a moment, having some difficulty forming words.
Of course. Just figures. It just figures.
So, are you gonna register for a guest pass?
Huh? Oh, right. Yeah, guest pass.
Sora tried to keep his eyes on the computer screen as he typed. Mostly because Aerith had been giving him the strangest look. He couldn't really tell what it is. And Kairi couldn't notice it with what her being very distracted was sifting through her purse for her account information. Once all of that was processed, Sora handed them Aerith's guest pass.
Here you go. Have fun.
Yeah, sure.
Kairi said hurriedly, very eager to leave. As the redhead tore down the hall, Aerith lingered a bit longer.
Fascinating.
Huh?
Nothing.
Aerith gave a strange wave and walked off. Left with an uneasy feeling, Sora tried to shrug it off. Yet, he had this feeling that Aerith was someone he needed to be careful. The ones with the nice exterior seemed to hide a repressed desire for danger. Sora was so distracted with these thoughts that it took him nearly a half hour to realize there was something on his desk that shouldn't be there. Kairi's purse. She must have been so distracted she didn't even notice.
Ah, crap. Maybe she didn't go into the pool yet.
Sora grabbed her purse.
Alicia, I need to step out. Can you fill in my spot for me real quick? Thanks!
The building's pool could only be accessed through the locker rooms. One for boys and one for girls. Usually, you couldn't go into the pool area until you had your swimsuit on. But Sora figured he was only going to be in there for a while. He wouldn't need to worry about changing. It didn't help that his run was filled with worst-case scenarios. Kairi accusing him of thievery and him falling down even lower in the barrel than he wanted to. He rounded the corner and quickly dashed into the locker room. Slowly down to a walk to avoid slipping on the wet tiles. Purse in hand, he was prepared to open the door to the other side. When something caught his attention, it was a bag, laying on one of the benches. He would usually ignore it, but the bag was one he saw recently.
Why is Aerith's bag in the boys' locker room? That's weird. Oh, no. Oh, this is not good. Okay, I better get out of here before.
I didn't realize that our little Sora had a perverted side.
Before that happens...
Sora spun around and his eyes widened when he saw Paine, dressed in one of the towels, hair wet, and regarding Sora with that smirk of hers.
Paine? What are you doing here?
I think that question is better suited to you. You are in the girls' locker room, after all. If that purse is meant as a disguise, perhaps you should have added a wig.
What? No. It's Kairi's. I was just trying to get into the pool to return to her, and... Well, I guess I'll just leave it here, then.
Sora sat the bag down on the bench and was about to leave when Paine's hand stopped his. When Sora turned around, Paine's expression was one he never saw on her before.
Since when did she become the center of your world?
She softened her grip on his hand. It was still damp from her time in the heated water, so it was rather warm.
I suppose she always was, in a way. Just not like this.
She's not the center of my world, Paine. I just owe her a lot. I made her life hell, and now I gotta own up to it.
Sora, you're fooling yourself. She has been since the moment you came to us. Cypher knew this, and he hoped you would find a way to move on from it.
She guided his hand up to her cheek.
Paine? What are you?
You're always the better of us, you know. Even under all that anger, you somehow smiled around us, made us smile too. You were always so nice. So considerate of us. Maybe a little too much. It's okay to not be so nice around me, you know. I don't mind.
Sora backed away from her quickly, nearly slipping in the tiles.
Okay, whoa no, Paine! What are you doing?
Paine was frozen for a moment before she put her hands on her hips.
Jeez, you can't seriously be asking me this question, can you?
Well, I am, because honestly, where did this even come from?
Sora, I have and always been interested in you. You were the new guy in our group, and you rose to power within the school very quickly. That's talent.
She began to saunter her way over to him.
And that talent is sexy.
Sora, for the first time in his life, found his brain actually backfiring, like the old car his mom used to drive. He quickly moved away from her again and began forcing his vocal cords to produce actual words.
Okay. Paine, this... Look, I don't really do this hookup kind of thing, okay? I mean, I've known you for 2 years, and yeah, don't get me wrong, you're rocking the whole goddess of temptation thing you got going on, but... Paine, this is not my thing. You're not my type.
What? A woman who's actually interested in you? Someone who has stood by your side and knows you? That's not your type?
No, not that. Paine, I just don't see you that way. I'm sorry, I really am, but I can't see you this way. I can't see us in this way. I'm sorry.
Paine seemed, well, not sugarcoating it, hurt. Very much so. Sora didn't want to remain here longer than he wanted, and he turned to walk off when she spoke.
She'll abandon you near the end, you know. The moment you mess something up, the moment she is hurt from something you do or say, she'll turn her back on you. You'll never get her to like you.
That's not the point. Never was. Whether she likes me or not is not my concern. I just gotta make up for everything I did to her.
So... what? She's your Beatrice or something?
My what?
Dante's Inferno, you know. Beatrice. You think making up to her is what? Redemption?
I don't know. I just have to show her that I'm sorry for the things that I've done to her.
And what about what you just did to me?
I'm sorry.
Sora walked out of the locker room, leaving Paine alone to stare at the spot where he stood.
Sorry's not enough.
Sora Shimomura, huh?
After a few hours of pool time, Cloud, Aerith, and Kairi were dried out and ready to step outside into the harsh snowfall.
He seems to be wherever I go lately. This whole thing has got me so confused about him now.
He seems sincere about this. Remember what he did this morning?
Yeah, I do. Cloud?
She turned to the older boy for his opinion. He gave a shrug and put his hands in his pockets.
I have... guarded optimism.
The three of them stepped outside and saw Sora Shimomura standing by the street, perhaps waiting for a ride to take him home. As the three of them bundled their coats up against the heavy snowfall, Paine watched them from further down the street, her eyes darkening when she saw the flash of red hair being covered by a pink snowcap. She reached into her coat pocket and pulled out a set of sticky notes, quickly scribbling a symbol on the paper. She brought it to her lips and kissed it. A purple-like glow surrounded the object, and she stuck it to a parked car on the street.
Get the redhead.
The car suddenly sprang to life, roaring in the snowfall. Paine gave a dark smirk and walked off. If she stayed around when Kairi was going to get splattered, she might be made out. No, she'll just have to imagine her guts all over the roadway. The car spun its wheels as Cloud and Aerith crossed the street. When Kairi began to follow them, it tore off, keeping its lights off until the last second. It was virtually unnoticeable, except that Sora saw it, or really, he heard it. Following the sound quickly, he saw the shape of a car begin to move to Kairi. He wanted to call out to her, but he knew she wouldn't hear it in time. He ran as fast as he could, pushing himself to the street as the car closed in. He could see Kairi freeze at the sound. He knew he didn't have much time. He shoved Kairi quickly out of the way and basked in his moment of triumph, only to be hit head-on with a car. His body rolled over the car hood and flew into the air before it crashed on the ground. The car swerved off and crashed into a street post, which caught Cloud and Aerith's attention.
What the?
Kairi shook her head from the nasty shove she got. Looking up, she saw the wrecked car, feeling a sinking feeling in her stomach when she realized that nearly hit her. And it sunk lower when she saw the body of who had hit instead.
Oh God! Sora! Sora, no!
She scrambled to her feet and pushed herself to Sora's body.
Sora! Sora!
Kairi, move!
Cloud called out as he ran to them. Kairi had lowered her head to his chest, and what she heard, or really didn't hear, caused her to go into a panic.
Cloud! He's not breathing!
Let me look at him. My dad's a doctor and I hung around the hospital enough to pick up some things. Now move out of the way!
Cloud began to go hard at work to bring Sora back to life. But little did he know as he worked there was someone else with him. Someone they couldn't see. He stood over Sora's body with his long dark coat, his receding hair and the eyes as cold as the snow around them.
You're no good to me, dead.
He raised the cane he had in his hands, the cane with the crystal skull on top, and slammed it to the ground.
Sora!
Kairi, in her relief, quickly threw her arms around him.
Kairi, his ribs!
Cloud warned as Sora yelled out in pain. She released him quickly as Cloud checked him over.
Sora, are you all right? What can you remember?
What happened?
You were hit by that car.
I was hit?
Okay. Kairi, help me move him. Gently, though. He needs to be out of the cold.
It was a bit of a struggle, but the two of them managed to bring Sora back into the recreation center, with Aerith coming in seconds later.
The driver's gone! I checked the car that hit the street post. No one was in the driver's seat.
The driver bolted? Alright. I'm going to call the police. Aerith, see if someone can give us a pillow or some towels for Sora's head. Kairi, you stay with him.
Cloud and Aerith quickly moved away to do their respective jobs, leaving the two of them by themselves.
Well, that kind of sucked.
You saved me. After everything I said, after I doubted you, you saved me.
So do you believe me now?
Kairi turned to Sora for a moment. Shame from her doubts threatened to creep up, and she cast her eyes downward.
I'm going to see if I can help Aerith.
She quickly rose up and departed, leaving Sora with his pain.
Well, I think that kind of went well. Damn. I thought that car would have killed me.
Consider that to be a one-time favor.
Sora's eyes widened at the voice. Even as the air chilled around him and even as the lights dimmed, it was that voice he couldn't forget.
You.
Mephisto, the devil himself, appeared in the foyer of the recreation center, hands on his cane and observing Sora with a look of disappointment.
You, the host of my greatest creation, killed in a hit and run. Rather ironic. I'm usually very big on irony, but that could just not do.
Wait. I was dead?
Yes, you were. For a moment, anyway. I usually don't interfere with these kinds of things, but it's far too early for you to die. It's also far too much of a hassle to select a new rider. So consider this a very rare gift of generosity. Or perhaps consider this a way to make sure you complete our contract. Don't worry. There'll be plenty of time for you in hell later.
At those words, Sora felt a rage bubble up inside him. Rage for the creature that stood before him and sealed his fate.
You tricked me. You tricked me into working for you!
The vampire caught on a lot quicker than I thought he would. I will have to keep an eye on him. But let me tell you something. I do not trick people.
He said this with a twisted smile on his face.
It's not my fault you didn't read every line of the contract. Or in your case, choose your words wisely. Everybody gets so eager to sign that dotted line. They don't really sit down and read what's on there. I suppose if they did, I would be out of a job. Well, thank the man above for stupid people.
Mephisto walked for the door that led outside.
This is the one and only time I will do this for you, Sora. If you don't look both ways when crossing the street like an intelligent person should, then I will see you in my kingdom. Oh, and Sora, this Vanitas, dispatch him quickly. The longer you wait, the worse things will become.
In a blink, Mephisto vanished. The lights returned and the air warmed, but not Sora. All he felt was cold. It was like he was still outside in the snow, all by himself with no one to help him up. He was so caught up with himself, he almost didn't notice Kairi returning with blankets.
Here, lift your head.
She guided a wad of blankets under his head.
How are you feeling?
The pain isn't so bad. Still hurts, but... no, not as bad.
All right, let me know if it gets worse. An ambulance is on the way, so everything will be fine.
Hey, Kairi. I'm sorry, okay?
Look, we should talk about this later.
No, let me... Look, I'm sorry for everything I did, okay? Ow, ow. I never should have bullied you like that. You did nothing to deserve it, and I'm sorry.
I know you are. I just... You did a lot of things, Sora. These past few years held some of the worst days of my life. I need a little time to get over them.
So, you believe me?
I have guarded optimism.
I guess that'll have to do.
Silence fell between the two of them as the snowstorm outside began to grow stronger.
Storm's getting worse. I hope the ambulance makes it.
Something tells me this storm's only the beginning.